Welcome to Global One Media Stocks to Watch. I'm Michael Suido. I'm speaking today with Eric Strand. He's the founder of AuAg Funds. They invest in precious metals, mining companies, and the green energy transition. Eric, great to see you again. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you very much, Michael.
You know, it has been several weeks now since Donald Trump was elected to a second term in the White House. Since then, he has announced nominees for his cabinet, including North Dakota Governor Doug Burgum for Secretary of the Interior, and hedge fund manager Scott Bessent to head the Treasury Department. The equity markets have generally applauded the election results, though the U.S. dollar has weakened a bit on Bessent's nomination. Eric, I'm curious, have you reshuffled your portfolio at all in response to Trump's victory and his cabinet choices?
No, we have not. I mean, of course, our strategy is to be long only, and we don't react on short-term noise, as we call it. And yes, there has been a lot of market reactions. I have a hard time to understand them, if I should be true. I mean, I understand what's happening, but I don't think that's the way it will play out, that what the market believes or believes the word from the incoming president.
So basically, you see all that as short-term noise, which doesn't really impact your vision, your strategy for the markets?
No, I mean, when we have seen the presidents, doesn't matter if they're Democrats or Republicans, I mean, they have added more debt to the state debt in the US, the M2, the how much money there is in the system has grown the same way. So everything is like the same in the end. But of course, the market or the algorithms, they listen to the words that maybe this administration will lower debt in the US, and course, that may be not good for some hard assets like gold. But I mean, that didn't happen last time Trump was president. I don't think it will happen again. But of course, it's easy to say, it's cheap to talk. So, but if the market reacts on that and believes it, okay, that's one thing. But I think they will rather push the pedal to the bottom and have lower rates, more debt, and let things going than really being hard on the economy. So I don't believe on that narrative, and we will see in the future if the market's reaction was correct or it was like wrong thinking about what's said and what's done.
That's an interesting insight. I want to go through a number of Trump's policies now and examine how they might impact metal prices. And let's start with tariffs, because that is really one of the biggest policies that he talks about all the time. Trump is promising to impose new tariffs as soon as he's inaugurated on January 20th. He says he's going to place 25% tariffs on products from Mexico and Canada. That would end a regional trade agreement that he renegotiated during his first term as president. He also wants to place an additional 10% tariff on goods from China. That is lower, though, than the 60% tax that he campaigned on. How do you think, Eric, that this is going to impact commodity prices?
But first of all, I think it's really sad that we're going from a globalization of the world, I mean, working together, that everybody should think about themselves first. I personally think that's a bit sad, and I think it will make a lot of things more expensive, and there are a lot more trade wars around the world. But actually, I also see that a lot of countries will compensate for the tariffs, if they are there, with devaluation of their own currencies. And if China compensates, devaluate with 10 or 20%, I would guess a lot of Chinese investors would prefer to buy gold before the devaluation of the currency. So I think there would be a big buying from countries where they see that devaluation of the currencies will come. So probably a lot of buying power to hard assets. That's what I would say.
That's interesting. So you're looking at a second order impact of the devaluation of the currency, and then people saying, hey, we don't want to be caught up in this asset inflation, if you will, or this inflation, and therefore we're going to buy gold. Now,
yeah, that's the way to protect yourself when this circle starts with devaluation in the different countries around the world.
So Trump's tariffs are part of a broader America First policy that's intended to boost domestic manufacturing. Some people wonder whether that might lead to higher demand for commodities in the U.S. and be another force that could push prices higher. What do you think?
Well, first of all, I think tariffs are something bad, and it's not a good way to start. And then maybe they will work in some concepts that, okay, more companies will start to produce in the U.S., they will get more jobs in the U.S. But on the other hand, other parts of the world will start to think the same. And I mean, in the end, it won't really benefit anybody. So it's a short-term thinking, very egoistic, and I think it would probably make things more expensive all around.
Okay, so let's look at geopolitics now, and specifically the conflicts in Ukraine and the Middle East. These have led many investors to seek safe haven investments like gold. It's still too early to know how Trump's policies are going to play out in these regions, though he has pledged to end the war in Ukraine. What are you watching for on this front?
Well, first of all, I mean, I think gold goes up because of the money printing. Sometimes it goes up because of uncertainties or trade wars, wars and so on, but that's normally short term. But as we speak, we have seen, I mean, talk about peace in the Middle East has taken gold down a little bit. I was a bit surprised because also the situation in Ukraine, Russia actually got more intense with the threat of more continental missiles or even the Third World War. So that should take gold price up, but it has not done that really. And I think that's much, I mean, for the world, much bigger situation. Of course, it's really sad in the Middle East, but I mean, Ukraine, Russia, continental, intercontinental missiles. I mean, that's really scaring for all of us. And I don't want gold to go up from that reason, but probably it should. So yes, and I mean, Trump, I don't know. He said he's going to make peace. I think, of course, that's good. He also said that he would send even more arms to Ukraine. I don't know if that's a threat to get to the peace. So, I mean, you get a lot of different mixed messages. One thing that I think is important with the peace that I hope for in Ukraine-Russia war is that actually commodities have been, the price of metals have been pushed down because Russia has been forced to sell their metals. I mean, we still buy the Russian metals because we cannot produce any airplanes, nothing without the Russian metals. Mm. We just forced them to sell them cheaper. So there has been a rebate in the world, pressure of the price of different metals because of this war. And if there is a peace and if countries can become friends again somehow, I think this rebate on Russian metals will disappear in a couple of years, and that will also take the metal prices higher.
I believe one of those metals is tungsten. What are some of the other ones from Russia? What are some of the other ones from Russia?
Titanium, we cannot do, as I said, no airplanes without titanium, and they are the largest producer in South Africa. So they are big commodity producers, and even the Russian oil didn't disappear from what we are using. It just takes another round. India, Saudi Arabia has been buying it cheap. Either they have been using it or they have been selling it further and made a profit on the cheap. Because, I mean, the Western world wants to hurt the Russian income from the commodity side. And they've done that. And with the peace, the prices will not be rebated longer anymore. So I think for metal prices, it would be good. And for the producers in the West, because there would be no competition of cheap Russian metals.
All right, let's turn to currencies now. The US dollar has risen moderately since the elections, and analysts expect it to rise further when new tariffs are imposed on China. Donald Trump, though, said he would prefer a weaker dollar because that would make US exports more competitive. Where do you see the greenback headed?
Well, it is an interesting situation, and I think the dollar has also been strong because what has been a bit unnormal is that the Fed has been the last, not maybe not the last one, but one really late, lowering rates. And normally the Fed is first to raise the rates and then they are the first to lower them. And now they've been not. So the rates have stayed higher a bit longer in the US, made the dollar stronger. But I think the Fed will raise more aggressively in the year coming. So that will give us a weaker dollar again. And I think that's Trump really wants the Fed to lower rates really fast, because I think that's the way he likes to run the economy. That's the way he would like, or even Elon Musk, to run their empires. They have had a lot of debt, and I think they like low rates. And they have no problem with inflation actually either.
So let's say that the dollar does weaken further. What do you think that means for gold and silver?
Well, first of all, I think there are reasons for the dollar to weaken because of the Fed. On the other hand, as I said before, a lot of countries will devaluate. So this will, like, all the values will somehow come down. So even if the dollar may weaken, but I mean, if the other currencies weaken because of devaluation, dollar could still look stronger than the other currencies. So it's like a really complicated game between the currencies, if they're really strong or weak or looking weak or whatever. So I think hard commodities like metals is a really good place to be, because they cannot be devaluated or inflated or are affected of lower rates. So that's the place.
All right, so we're going to circle back to inflation now. It's nearing the Fed's 2% target, but just about every economist that I've read, they believe that the Trump tariffs and those counter tariffs that you've mentioned that could be imposed by US's trading partners, that those are going to lead to higher consumer prices. This in turn could lead the Fed to hold off on further interest rate cuts or perhaps even reverse course and start raising rates again. What do you think happens?
Well, I believe in the first part of that, but I think we are coming to that point where we will have to live with a higher inflation. I mean, we cannot win the fight against that inflation. And I mean, we have lived through higher inflation earlier. I think the target with 2%, I mean, that's what we accounted as inflation. I mean, sometimes the price inflation is much higher than we see, the 2%. And actually, I think all these countries with so much debt, I mean, the way to get rid of debt, the easiest way is with inflation. So I think there will be a new game, and we will not stay at the 2%, and the Fed will lower rates.
Okay, so before we wrap up, you know, behind you, there are some pictures of ancient Rome. And we were chatting just before we started recording, and you were sharing an anecdote with me going back to the Roman Empire about what happens in an empire when the currency is debased. So could you just tell us a moment about Roman silver?
Yeah, Roman and silver, I mean, that was the metal used in the coins, and they had like 95% silver in the coins when the empire was strong in the beginning. And of course, they started it and they did just wars, and they had not so much, didn't work that hard, didn't have so much income. They had parties, they had the Colosseum, they had everything, the show and spectacles. But the money was not coming in, and they had to print more. And in the end, when the Roman Empire went under, there was less than 5% silver in the coins. So that was the inflation of that time. And actually, if we look at all empires through history, they have had the same thing is happening. And we have seen that also now. I mean, now dollar has been the reserve currency. Before it was the pound. Now it's the dollar. But since 1971, when we separated gold and the dollar has lost approximately 99% of its value vs gold. And that's just over 50 years.
So what lesson do you draw from that when it comes to the United States?
Debt, we are living in a world of debt. That's how the system works. And I think that will continue, and it will just become more. Maybe one day, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, there will be just too much, and we have somehow to reset the system. But I don't think that will happen yet, because for politicians, the easiest way is to push debt forward.
All right. So coming back to the time of Trump, what advice would you have for people who are watching this, for investors, as they seek to navigate any Trump turbulence?
Well, that is difficult, because, I mean, sometimes they say things and then they do something else, and let's see what happens. I think maybe Trump will be strong and hard maybe the first 2 years. In the last 2 years, I think he will think a lot about his legacy as a good or friendly president that people loved. And I think he will be very combative to do good things that people also like, not just what he thinks is correct, but also thinking about his legacy. So maybe there will be some turbulence, a lot of turbulence, probably with trade wars or tariffs and so on. But in the end, I think he will soften and become a nice president.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what, in 4 years, we're going to play back this tape and see what actually happened. Eric, it's been great chatting with you.
Yeah. Thank you.
We've been speaking with the founder of AuAg Funds, Eric Strand, and you've been watching Global Media Stocks to Watch. I'm Michael Sweato.